I would like to thank especially Anthony Wong for coordinating, announcing, and organizing this event. Russell Leong is the editor who kept persuading and urging me to publish this long poem and finally got it in decent shape, I think, and good shape actually, thanks to his editorial advice. And also very grateful to Loretta Chin, who helped edit the piece. I would like to, this piece is dedicated to David Ludden, who years ago told me that you can find out so much history by following just one crop, such as sugar. So it sparked a thought, and I thought about opium. So this is a whole long meditation on opium. And I will just begin with an introduction, a brief introduction. My meditation on opium is drawn from close personal experience. A beloved cousin died of a heroin overdose. A revered granduncle became an addict who died penniless, wasted, and sick. During my father's last days, he staved off the pain of cancer by swallowing opium pellets purchased illegally from the streets, helped by my sister, who is here. Growing up in Malacca, Malaysia, one was surrounded by opium all around. In next-door neighbors' waftings from their evening pipe, in shady dens and opium houses visible at marketplaces and alleyways, and in crime scenes attributed to purveyors and desperate addicts of Dadah, the Malay word for heroin. Moving to Vermont, I see that opium has followed me here too, with addiction and crime reaching alarming proportions, so much as to prompt the governor to announce it publicly at his recent State of the State address. Opium has touched many lives around the world, especially in China, which fought two wars against the British to battle its importation. It has special significance for Chinese people as a symbol of Western colonialism, exploitation, and duplicity. Researching its history, I learned how it grew from ancient medical practice to capitalist commodity, serving the aggrandizement and profit-seeking of empire. Contrary to popular Western thinking, Chinese opium smoking was neither native nor self-inflicted, but knowingly promoted by European and American traders bent on acquiring the goods that they craved from the imperious Chinese. It has simply suited the Western imagination and conscience to depict Asiatics as weak victims of their ungovernable cravings. An illicit trade in opium, mostly by British traders, contributed to Indian revenues and financed the purchase of Chinese silks and teas for the British market. In protest, the Qing government finally intervened and burned a large consignment. This led to the First Opium War, 1839 to 1842, and the Second, 1856 to 1860. The British won the wars, and opium remained an exportable commodity until 1911. The Treaty of Nanking gave the British the right to trade and reside at five ports, including Hong Kong. Later treaties signed by France and the United States gave other foreigners the same privileges. Addiction can be universal. From the relatively mild British habit of tea drinking to the American consumption of coffee, alcohol, tobacco, oil, even daily news, especially on the internet. Delving into history, I see that the British themselves became addicts of opium, their practices reaching far and wide across class and age, so that infants were quieted by special solutions and housewives calmed by tonics, while ladies and lords indulged commonly in the substance known as laudanum. What lessons can be gleaned from these historical explorations may be summed up for myself as understanding and compassion in the face of loss and blame. So I will read now my series of poems and linked archival historical pieces. Some of them are from historical texts, some from archives, but the rest of the works are by me, the poems and the anecdotes. So the first piece is called Papaver Somniferum, which is the Latin name for the opium poppy. There are a couple of references here, names in India where opium was grown. There's a reference to Bokhara, which is a kind of rug, a Persian oriental rug. And tekkas are camel hoof designs, which are very common in oriental rugs from Persia. Papaver somniferum. There is a flower whose power drives me to ends irretrievable, whose brim is copious light and insatiable dark. In its flarings are full thrillings. In its heart, the sun has made a haven of concentrated allure. I remember the field red as blood, blood coursing swollen veins, a galloping wave, great Bokhara I ride deliriously upon, sprawled over vermilion medallions, green tekkas flocking, pulsating, insistent as many dyings. Neither beetle nor worm munches upon this bright platter without ingesting pure redness or reckoning with a lazy seed at the core, a kasipur capsule I slit for cream oozings, sweet gum dripping second by second from Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, and Rajasthan. I hold in my hand a stalk. I suck at the pipe and taste my own loneliness. I suck some more and taste nothing like mortality. What flower knows how to entwine its legs around me so? What will I do with my longing? This ravenous bloom, this silent unfurling, envelops my world. I touch a petal. It comes full-fledged and feels a child's cheek. I ride her back, I climb her ladder. The flower haunts me with its riddle of pure devotion. Here's a sort of a epigraph from a book called Opium, the Poisoned Poppy by Michael Robson. And it's about all the traders that were in China. They were all at it, the Greeks, the Dutch, the New English or North Americans, the Swedes, the French and Spanish, the Danes, the Latin Americans, and Jardine Matheson, occupying the largest, most favorable, and picturesque of the warehouses that boasted its broad veranda overlooking a lush garden and a sidelong view of that well-trodden thoroughfare of commerce, Hog Lane. So Jardine Matheson was a huge, huge British company that had headquarters in Malacca, my hometown. Still here, yes. And they had the largest wharves and go-downs in my hometown. Here is a letter from William Jardine to La Roulette and Company, Singapore, 24 May, 1819. It's from the Jardine collection cited in Opium and the Empire, Chinese Society in Singapore. I am of opinion that a person settling here for a few months with a few thousand dollars as a circulating medium, which they greatly want, might carry on business to great advantage. I dare say that opium might be now retailed at $1,300 per chest, but there is no individual who could afford to buy so large a quantity as a chest, the sale of which must be the work of many days. Mr. Bernard, son-in-law of the Major Farquhar, who is master attendant, is an inexperienced youth and knows not to take advantage of his opportunities. I offered to sell him opium for government bills on Bengal, but could not prevail him to venture on such a purchase. All right, here's an anecdote close to home. When I was 6 or 7 years old, my granduncle took me to his opium den. He was serious and sober as we left, walking with a stiff, straight bearing. We shepherded the goats into the goat shed, which I swept daily of just hard turd pellets. We walked down the sandy driveway from grandmother's house, taking care to stay on the side of the road that was shaded by the fruit trees, guava, coconut, chiku. I could hear the wind tickling the leaves of the coconut tree. Shrr, shrr, shrr. I was 6 years old and I held granduncle's hand. We walked down what they used to call the horse carriage road, Ma Cha Lu, sometimes stepping over to the grass edge when we heard the bell of a passing trishaw. Soon we got nearer to town. We passed the main street they call Jalan Bunga Raya, turned into a side alley with its little low doors for the outhouse shit pots to be collected. We turned some more and found a narrower lane, walked up a dark flight of stairs. I could hear voices and smelled an acrid smell like that of burnt sweet potatoes. We entered a low, dingy room. I could hardly see in the dark. Then my eyes made out the shapes of people on the floor, lying on their sides like sleeping goats. I could hear gurgling water sounds and made out little spots of light. Here and there were old men lying around. Granduncle found an empty mat and told me to sit nearby. I saw him take a pipe and put a lump on a stick over an oil lamp flame. It looked as if he was cooking a piece of goat turd. He put it to his pipe and joined the others with a gurgling. Once in a while, he would cough a bit. The reclining figures breathed slowly and deeply, almost in rhythm. I fidgeted, looking around. I saw a cat stretch his limbs and move away. It seemed as if we were there a long while Granduncle got up wobblily and patted my head. He gave a woman some money. When we got out into the open, the sun seemed so bright and hot. Granduncle shuffled along, weaving his footsteps crookedly while I skipped along beside him. One night I was in bed with Taiyi. There was a bright moon outside, so I could see the shapes of mango trees outlined against the sky. Taiyi was already asleep. Suddenly, a man appeared. He was dark and handsome, dressed in a white sharkskin suit. Even then, I recognized it as a sharkskin suit. He had curly hair and a mustache and looked like the film actor P. Ramlee. He smiled a knowing smile and wagged a finger at me as if to say, "Naughty girl, I know what you are doing." I nudged at my aunt, "Taiyi, Taiyi, there's someone at the window." When Taiyi sleepily rose, the man ducked under the windowsill. Taiyi looked up briefly, then went back to sleep. The man bobbed his head up again and again smiled and wagged his finger at me. I woke Taiyi again. Again he ducked. Then he made a beckoning gesture to his left, and soon other characters appeared outside the window. They all arranged their heads in different angles to look at me. Then each one slipped into the room through metal bars that I myself could hardly squeeze through. When they entered the room, they began to look around. One came under my bed and thumped my mattress from underneath. Two or three others disappeared under Uncle's housecoat hanging on a nail. They emerged a little later and all held hands and did a dance. A couple of them turned into a red thermos, which later turned into a Buddha statue. I woke Taiyi again. This time she got really mad. "Now you are scaring me," she yelled. "I'm taking you to another room." So she carried me off to the back room. They followed me off all the way, half trailing, half flying, like figures in a Chagall painting. As I was falling asleep, I saw their faces floating in the ventilation hole up above me, smiling at me. These are all family pictures, specially compiled for my sister Wun Yin's birthday. That's Duncan when he was a hippie. This is a very famous letter, especially to Chinese people. It's a letter from Commissioner Lin Zexu to Queen Victoria, 1840. "The way of heaven is fairness to all. It does not suffer us to harm others in order to benefit ourselves. Men are alike in this all over the world, that they cherish life and hate what endangers life. Your country lies 20,000 leagues away, but for all that, the way of heaven holds good for you as for us, and your instincts are not different from ours. For nowhere are there men so blind as not to distinguish between what brings life and what brings death, between what brings profit and what does harm. Our heavenly court treats all within the four seas as one great family. The goodness of our great emperor is like heaven that covers all things. All opium discovered in China is being cast into burning oil and destroyed. Any foreign ships that in the future arrive with opium on board will be set fire to, and any other goods that they are carrying will inevitably be burnt along with opium. You will then not only fail to make any profit from us, but ruin yourselves into the bargain. Intending to harm others, you will be the first to be harmed. Another anecdote about my late father. I think there's some pictures of him here. Chin Sai Chong, he was a doctor of Chinese medicine, and as a member of the Kuomintang, he fought in the resistance against the Japanese. Memories of shame. Sometimes in the evening, if father was not out on call, if he was not sitting in brooding solitude on a cool evening, unwashed by rain or unbearable heat, we would all sit out in the hall, usually kept for patients or for the rubber dealers who had rented desk space and kept four telephones ringing. Sometimes on those evenings, when even poor families found time to be together, mother resting in a cane chair, actually resting, not cooking, not soothing a screaming child, father in his striped pajamas, relaxing under the ceiling fan, he would begin on the subject again, as if it had all happened just yesterday, as if he knew each and every one of the players. Now I tell you, what kind of reason is it if a stranger comes calling to your house and wants to buy your things but has nothing you want to buy? What reason is it if you tell this stranger, this rude, unruly stranger, to go away? But does he go away? No, he doesn't. He wants what you have, your tea, your silk, your medicines. This is your house. Don't you have the right to tell him to leave? No, because this stranger is not like other strangers. This is a devil. He has no reason. He has no qualms. Let me tell you what kind of creature he is. He's a liar and a thief. He wants your wares and has nothing to offer you in return. It's your house, your backyard. You have every right to tell him to go, yes or not? But does he go? Of course not. He hangs around. He brings his guns. He declares a war. He sneaks in something that weakens you. He slips in his apen yen so that you cannot fight back. What kind of behavior is this? He uses the silver you spend on his opium smoke to buy your silks, your tea, your medicines, and calls this trading. Is this legal? Is this right? No. This is the worst kind of cheating and injustice. This is no way for a civilized person to behave. How can any decent being put up with this? This is what they did to us. Here's another archival piece from Arthur Whaley, The Opium War Through Chinese Eyes. First excerpt is from Lord Jocelyn's journal, 6 months with the Chinese expedition, 1841. This section is called Lawful Loot, The Fall of Qinghai. Silks, fans, china, little shoes, the articles of a Chinese lady's toilette lay tossed in a sad and telltale melee, and many of these fairy shoes were appropriated by us as lawful loot. Second excerpt from an eyewitness account published in the China Repository, also in Arthur Whaley's book. They have in 1,000 instances received great injustice at our hands. While we have been issuing proclamations, talking sweet words, our soldiers and sailors have been plundering them and forcibly carrying off their poultry and cattle. We are now going to break open all the unoccupied shops and houses and take possession of them for governmental purposes. Okay, the next section is called The Opera Singer's Olive. This is a reference to the retired Chinese opera singers that used to wander in the amusement parks and outdoor restaurants. They'd play a little scratchy erhu, and they'd put a little dried olive on your table. You're not supposed to eat it, you're supposed to give some money and then you take the olive. So anyway, I was always struck by this Chinese opera singer and with his erhu, so I tried to imagine what he would say. Let's see. Yes, I sound tragic. Tragedy was once my triumph. I could squeeze a tear from the most hardened Tai Tai and Tai Ban. My frame was strong and my face was smooth. I walked with a swagger and somersaulted across the world. When I opened my mouth to sing, the notes poured out like treacle, notes I could hold like solid streams, like swords to pierce the canopy of heaven. Who had not heard my name, or seen my fine face, or thrilled to my clean tunes? But I had to sing again and again, night after night, week after week, month after month. So I ate the shit to keep me going. At first it let me drag out the notes even longer and sweeter, until they thought I was blessed by divine spirits or a companion to the fairies. Then I needed more and more until the cracks began to show. The shit began to crud my teeth, my throat, my vocal cords. Soon I could no longer play Liang San Bo or Scholar Zhang. Soon I could only do medium range roles, fierce father, old grandfather, and then the bit parts, the very, very small parts. I forgot the lines, the notes, the entrances, the exits. Soon they had to show me the way out. Well, I can still squeeze out a tune. I can still squeeze a tear from your eyes, maybe not by the same means or for the same reason. I can still make you cry though. Just don't eat the olive I gave you. It's rather old and dry and I need it for my next table. Coming to the end, the wars. On June 3rd, 1839, the destruction of the opium began. This is from Peter Ward Fay, The Opium War. On June 3rd, 1839, the destruction of the opium began, and from now onwards, Commissioner Lin records day by day the quantity disposed of, just as in previous weeks he had recorded the quantity surrendered. On June 13th, he sent to the emperor an account of the way in which the opium was being destroyed. This, like the delivery, required an immense amount of meticulous organization. Hong Kong was occupied. On the 26th of 1840, Bremer landed with a large party and formally took possession. Elliot says that he sees no objection to our storing opium there, Matheson wrote Jardine, and as soon as the New Year's holidays are over, I shall set about building. Here we are at the island of Hong Kong in the most delicious state of uncertainty. You are aware the trade is open. Captain Elliot only thinks and dreams of this, as if it was the sole object of the frightful outlay of money expended and expending. This section is called The Names. Laudanum Paracelsi, Stone of Immortality, Venice Treacle, Mithridate, Sidenum Laudanum, Dr. Bates's Pacific Pill, London Laudanum, Tincture Tobicum, Elixir paregoricum, confectio opiato, Dr. Dover's powder, black drop, Godfrey's cordial, Dolby's carminative, McMunn's elixir, Batley's sedative solution, Mother Bailey's quieting syrup. Horse, smack, lady, chandu, cek putih, dada, dada, dada. This is a poem in the voice of my cousin Mike, who died of an overdose. It's called Rocky Road. We have just two or three more stages. Rocky Road. Days without are the hard mile I walk, aching for the knowledge. Succumbing, I am bereft. With a flourish, I give in to the ritual of desperation. Pompous, pathetic, knowing, always knowing that I am nobody in the cosmos created by the economy of evil, that I am slave to another's engorgement as well as my own, counting the minutes, the shrinkings, the wastings. My friends have deserted me all. Family is a synonym for bereavement. I am queen of selfishness, master of ceremony, tailor of destruction, absconder, citizen of the parasite nation, companion of blackguards, joiner of the secret society, worshipper in the temple of pariahs, yodeling to the gods for mercy, screaming for the pounding in the brain, the temples, pulse, solar plexus, pitfall, pounding pain. Drum of death, brother drum, cousin drum, drum of delirium, drum of perdition. Release me, O Jesus, O mother, O goddess of mercy. Who gave you the key to my undoing? Why am I someone else altogether? What is it chokes my air? Who gave birth to such wallowing? Why is salvation not salvation? I cannot recognize the face in the mirror. I have known it too long to loathe it so deeply. God, if I could just unscrew my being from this stem, I would feel my whole self again. A brief excerpt from Alethea Hayter, Opium and the Romantic Imagination, about the late stages, and it's called Late Stages. This is Sonia, who is here. Late stages. They are often tortured by reptiles and insects, embraced by coiling snakes, trampled on by monsters, crawled on by worms, by ants, by microbes, thrust over precipices by tortoises or fiery dragons. His very identity is in danger. He's falling to pieces. His head is hollow. He's being merged with a character in a book or with the furniture in the room. He has become the opium itself and is being smoked in a pipe by the king of the island addicts. One more poem from Michael, my cousin. The title is, Am I Not Bumiputra Too? Bumiputra is a Bahasa Melayu word, Malay, for designating people of the Malay race, which translates as prince or princess of the soil, which confers upon them special privileges, in effect legislating a vast system of discriminatory privileges and making the other races, Indians, Chinese, Aboriginals, second-class citizens, basically. It's not quite like the affirmative action that we have here. Am I not Bumiputra too? You reach for a smoke and find none. Your father is dying in a room full of desiccated roaches and seahorses. You are dreaming of escape to where everyone speaks your lingo and music fills the air. Feliciano's quavering like your very own imitations, only more desperate because you know you're not wanted in this country of royal assholes. It's easy to reach for the sky. It's postcard blue, fringed with coconut throbbing songbirds and Tanjung Bidara-esque boulders round as mama's breasts, a sky scarred by jet plane streaks calls to you, leave, leave before you are forgotten of fodder, become invisible as white ink, latecomer, pariah you, sweet, sweet escape somewhere to rub shoulders with the likes of Santana. Oh man, what a life you could make if you didn't succumb to the jumps. One hit, just this once, I swear, and I won't again. The creeps from Creepsville are creeping in, 100 hairy legs all over goddamn Dadah, sweet as doddle. Gimme, gimme more. This is the life of the cool detached, because you know you don't really belong, but how did you know it would get so you can't breathe without your shit? And Portuguese town ain't always friendly. Blood squirts the ceiling, telltale drools, eyes going hazy. Can't see mama's tearing her hair and brother's turned into a repo man. You're losing that fear of being trapped, the feeling you'll never get out of this murk of a town with the authorities hurling slogans and aunties preaching churchy nothings. This is the final section. It's called Findings. In the darkness, I have been visited, a breathing unlike my own, heard between sleep and awakeness. My dear dead visiting tentatively, not to harm or travail, just a humming visitation of the dear torturously departed. They have nothing portentous to tell, nothing vicious, malevolent, or maligning. They are our beloved cousins, molested by time, whose visages we can scarcely grasp. Darlings of vapor, how I adored them, not knowing their lives were so entwined with mine. Not knowing if I turned this way or that, I was kissing my cousin. We are cousins in monkey's heaven. We are all cousins to the monkey. They have a message from the flower of history, not to repeat their helplessness, foolishness, or naivete. They parade their charred pasts, and I am stunned by my ignorance, my refusal to see the lineages of responsibility. Who is to blame for their neglect? Where can I find the hand that whipped ancestors or ravaged ancestresses? What is this colorful costume I don, playing the cosmopolite or charlatan, monkeying around with mortality? Somewhere the countdown has begun. I want to stay the hand that whips, that steals, that pillages my time, pulls down my pants and sticks it up my wants. I want to want it badly, not to be taken for a monkey, to say this time it will be different. I am born to be greater than a slave. My coolie ancestors who toiled in the mud and in the mines tell me they lacked not a single jot of dignity. They come to me in the wind, jingling wind chimes, bearing gifts of the tongue, the touch, the taste. Eat this bitter fruit, child. We divest you of your addictions. Rescue your father from purgatory. Let his sermon be heard, for he loved his wretched and proud brothers and sisters, and I am one of them. Do not go combing the sea for your cousin's bones. The salt has cleaned them of their distinctions. He is sand, all sand. Face your deepest desires, and you will see they do not let you down. There's goodness at the heart of the flower. Only goodness lets you find it unsullied. Only bravery offers the warrior redemption. Thank you, folks. Do we have time for Q&A or any comments? A few minutes, comments, questions? No questions?
What is the state of opium today in China?
Banned. The moment Mao came in, there was no more opium.
Just gone away.
Done away, yeah, prostitution. Yeah.
Afghanistan. Yeah.
Do you know you have a question?
I'm curious, you know, when your father, it was just wonderful.
Thank you.
It was just absolutely captivating. The stories your father used to tell about British colonialism, basically.
Yeah.
And this the Chinese house that gets taken over by the uninvited guests.
Yeah.
Is that something that was common, a usual, or just among people fighting?
Common in our household.
Common in your household.
Yeah.
Is that a common trope? Is
That was a trope for him.
British colonialism in India or South Asia, I'm not sure if that kind of story would have been common, perhaps. But I was very struck by that.
Yeah. For him, it was like a personal affront, you know, like it happened to him. Other relatives didn't talk like that. He was very political, and he was a crypto resistance fighter. None of us knew until long after he had died that he was very active in the resistance. So he was very, very passionate about it. Yes.
You mentioned he was member of the Kuomintang. Was he based in Malaya?
Yes,
at the time?
Yes. There was quite an active Kuomintang
not
there.
Mainland China?
No. He couldn't go back after the communists took over because Kuomintang was out of favor already.
Taiwan.
Yeah. So, yeah, they had a whole branch of the Kuomintang in Malaysia and Southeast Asia.
Right.
And Sun Yat-sen came out.
It ended in 1945, though, but the communists didn't come until 1949.
Yes.
But he was based in
Malaysia.
The entire time up until
all that time. War. Yeah, he came in the 1920s and stayed there. Yeah.
So the obvious question is: do you think there was an internal civil war going on with the Chinese in Malaysia? Then you had the Kuomintang and you had the Maoists. Would they have also had groups in Malaysia, where they have had a civil war going on there as well?
Not until after 45.
Uh-huh.
Then the Kuomintang.
Then it became
like a guerrilla war.
Japanese.
Yeah, Japanese. And they now, all united.
And now you fight against each other.
Yeah. Then so after the Japanese were driven out,
right.
The British came back, which really disappointed everybody. So they went into the jungle.
Yeah.
So the Chinese who were in the resistance mostly formed the Communist Party and went underground in the jungles. Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
So there was no civil war because they were united.
Because the British were on top of everybody.
Yeah. The British disappeared. They ran.
Right.
When the Japanese took over Singapore, they all disappeared. They didn't stay back to defend Singapore even.
Right.
So the Japanese took over for about 5 years. Yeah.
There was a photo saying gold tiger or something like that. What is that in reference?
This my sister was a tiger.
And that refers to?
I was the top sales lady. And tiger actually is, I was working for Yellow Pages. And they refer, you know, tigers and tiger.
Okay.
Yeah.
That means that champion.
Yeah.
Champion
yeah. One line. This before line.
One yellow.
Yeah. She was the dynamite sales lady. Yeah. Tigers are very, very powerful symbol in China, Malaysia. When we were growing up, there were tigers everywhere.
Yeah.
Tigers attacking people in rubber estates and so forth.
I think that story, we were roommates. I will never forget. The first time her first client, she came home, she told me, she said, "You're not going to believe who my first client was." I said, "Who?" "He sells coffins." And I told him, "If you don't put your store in the Yellow Pages, nobody will buy coffins from you."
Do you have that picture in front of the dispensary, your father?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There were some really nice pictures of
yeah.
the family.
Yeah.
I loved it.
Yeah.
Mark would look so fantastic.
She was, yeah. They were all mostly gathered for Wen Yin's big birthday party. Chloe put them all together, so that's why she's the star of this collection.
But what about the story of your uncle, which is fantastic, taking you to the opium den? Now, why was he taking you? Because he was charged with babysitting?
We were practically glued to him. Wen Yin and I played with him, we listened to all his stories.
Yeah.
He was so sweet to us. We went everywhere with him. When we couldn't afford opium, we would run back to our father's place, scream and yell, "We want money for opium. We want money for opium." For granduncle.
You like those dreams.
We want 50 cents for uncle's opium.
That's a fantastic scene with you.
I never put the two together. I had these amazing dreams, and then finally I realized I was up having side stream smoke. Any further questions before we disband? There's lots of... Hey, David Ludden!
You missed it.
Do it again.
Tell them the dedication.
Yeah. Oh, the dedication. The whole piece was dedicated to you because you planted the first seed in my mind that you can follow, you can learn so much about history by just following the history of one crop, such as sugar. So I started thinking about opium, and I never forgot.
Amitav Ghosh.
Amitav Ghosh, yes.
So thank you so much.
So we have wine, rum, water, tea,
and the book.
And the book, yes.
You have these pictures in a CD?
Yes.
Can I have a copy?
Chloe has them. These books are on sale for $10, and my poem is in it. It's a very nice issue.